wait on us. To God be the glory. That's a great one.
For our call to worship. Our Father, we thank you that your love for us is true and real. Your love is faithful until the end. And through Jesus and his resistance of temptation, he remained pure and became our once for all perfect sacrifice for our sin. Help us to follow you all the way. Help us to love you, serve you, and do your will. Help us to stand firm against the darkness of this world and follow you, no matter the cost. We pray in the name of your Son, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. In my head, I was getting excited, and I didn't say the your Son part right. I was like, I was just saying it. It was just coming to me. Thank you, praise and worship team, for leading us this morning so far. And I'm going to ask you to join me within your scriptures, the reading of Psalms 119, verses 25 through 32, as we prepare our hearts for that deeper worship. I lie in the dust. Revive me by your word. I told you my plans, and you answered. Now teach me your decrees. Help me understand the meaning of your commandments, and I will meditate on your wonderful deeds. I weep with sorrow. Encourage me by your word. Keep me from lying to myself. Give me the privilege of knowing your instructions. I have chosen to be faithful. I have determined to live by your regulations. I cling to your laws. Lord, don't let me be put to shame. I will pursue your commands, for you expand my understanding. Amen. That one's a hard one to come through, but come to our time of praying together and sharing in that together. So if you have your little slip, you can write your name, address, email, and prayer requests if you want to write them down. Friends who are praying and joining us online for worship, you're welcome to put your prayer requests in the comments, and we will absolutely love to share those with you and to pray with you. You'll have a moment of silence here while we share within the room, and then we'll come together for corporate prayer. Thanks. Thank you. wonderful and amazing God. It's incredible to us that in the span of things that you wanted to create, you created one of us. That in this amazing thing that you call life or creation, everything that we are stems from everything that you are. And it's when we forget that, that we miss out on the actual true goodness and lovable things in life. How often we take for granted the laughter of someone that we love and we don't realize it until it's gone. How much we miss the people and the relationships in our lives, and that's because that's the way you made us. You made us to be relational because that's who you are. You created us in your image. You made us this way. You made us with a spark that seeks for eternity. We don't want to die. And that's because you've given us this eternal life in which you want this to last forever. Not the sorrow, not the heartache, not the grief, not the sickness, not the disease, and not the pain. What you want is the relationship, and you want the love, and you want the praise, and you want the worship, and you want all of those good things in our life to last forever. And that's where Jesus came in. This son of yours decided that it was time to right the wrong once for all for human beings. And so he came to this earth to be a sacrifice for us. No more burnt offerings, he said. Our once for all offering for our lives was hung on a cross. And it's what gives us the ability to come together as those who believe him and those who believe in you, God. And we come together and we share our hearts with each other. We bear each other's burdens and we come together in love because this is who you are and it's who you've created us to be. And so this morning, as we've been praying and asking, you've been listening, not because we're good enough, not because we said the right things, not because we've attended a small group or because we put enough money in the box. It's because of who Jesus is. He has saved us from ourselves. He has saved us from the sin that we cannot earn our way out of. And you have adopted us as sons and daughters of yours. You've called us to the ability to come to this throne, to come to your feet, and to lift these to you. We've been lifting a lot to you this morning. Those who are sick, those who are getting clear cancer diagnoses, those whose scans are good, those whose scans are not good, and those who are dealing with transplants and all of the different things that they're going through in their life. We know that there's who are sick, those who are doing better, some that are still having a rough time, and even so, those of us who are still battling grief. Everything on this spectrum, it feels like we're trying to just use you as a genie in the bottle, but unfortunately, these are the areas in which life hurts. There's also parts of our lives that are really good. Parts of our lives where we get to see new life. We get to experience goodness. We get to see the sunshine this morning. We get to feel the warmth of a loved one's embrace, and we get to hear their laughter, and we get to share in those relationships. God, there are so many good things in this life. And amidst all of it, you've basically given this time for us, which we have no idea how long we have. And you've asked us to steward that time. You've asked us to care for that time so that we can make it the best that it can be. God, I pray that you would give each of us the strength and courage today to admit our faults, to admit our weaknesses, and to ask for help. You are the God of forgiveness. You are the God of renewal and restoring every day of our lives. And so in this moment of silence, we want to address you directly, bring ourselves to you, bring the brokenness that we have to you. Let us let our guard down so that we can be healed. Lord, hear us. Hear our voice even as it shudders. Hear us as we're afraid you might not love us for what we've done. Hear us as we're unsure where we're going and what's next. Hear us as we battle these earthly temptations and these things in our lives, that you might restore our minds, you might restore us physically, and you might restore us emotionally, that in all three aspects we can experience your goodness in our life. Allow us to understand that perfect is not what you call us for, but present is what you call us for. You call us to be in the moment, you call us to be listening, and you call us to be a participant in this relationship. And as we get deeper and deeper into this relationship, you'll move us. And we pray that we'll be ready to move when you ask us. God, we pray your Holy Spirit would pour out on us today. Give us your words, give us your wisdom and guidance, and allow us to see you in a new light. Allow us to experience a life-changing moment here within your Spirit. It is your Son, Jesus, who makes all of this possible. Without his resistance of temptation, we wouldn't be here. Without his admitting that he didn't want to go through with it, but he was going to follow you anyway, we wouldn't be here. Without his allowing himself to be crucified and separated from you, we wouldn't be here. And his rising from the grave and defeating sin and death, the triumph, that's what we're here for. God, may you give us the courage and strength to see Jesus for who he is, our Savior, the lover of our souls, the author and perfecter of our faith. And may we follow him. May we listen to his teaching. May we listen to you, God, as you enlighten us in who your Son is. And may we follow him without fear into whole new places. Have the courage and strength to stand firm, to meet together as you call us to, so that we can pray the prayer together that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, and we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Sorry. Thank you for praying with me, praying together. I don't want us to forget, there's an insert in here. We had a family in town that suffered a fire, and this is good information. I know Darcy's one of those people that you can contact and get her things, and she can get them to that. Deb is as well. And so anything that we can do to help this family is pretty cool and good. I know this Riverside family is awesome, and they've already done a lot, and they've been helping. And that's what we do. That's what family is. That's what relationships are. It's really good. It's really good. If you're able to stand and join me today for the reading of Scripture, you can. As always, God will speak to you sitting down. You don't have to stand up. Today, I'm going to read to you from Matthew chapter 4. How many of you have been in the little pamphlet, the Lent pamphlet? Where'd Deb go? I know she's been in it. Deborah, I know she's been in it. Yep, there you are. You're walking away. I took my glasses off because I have to see here. I can't see you. If you notice and you paid attention, it led you down through these three things, right? Anybody? Yeah, yeah. Oh, man. Make it note that this plan was set, and it's not actually to the lectionary. And that pamphlet was bought by Sarah without my knowledge. So none of that ties together, just so you know, other than what God's planned. Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. And then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted there by the devil. For 40 days and 40 nights he fasted and became very hungry. During that time, the devil came and said to him,
"If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become loaves of bread." And Jesus told him, "No. The scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone, but by the very word that comes from the mouth of God." Well, then the devil took him to the holy city, Jerusalem, to the highest point of the temple, and said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off. For the scriptures say, he will order his angels to protect you, and they will hold you up with their hands, so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone." And Jesus responded, "The scriptures also say, you must not test the Lord your God." And next the devil took him to the peak of a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. "I will give it all to you," he said, "if you will kneel down and worship me." "Get out of here, Satan," Jesus told him. "For the scriptures say, you must worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And then the devil went away, and the angels came and took care of Jesus. This is God's word for God's people. You may be seated. So how was your week? Busy? Busy? Crazy? Busy? Ha. Warmer, wetter, right? I forget where I was, if it was last night or if it was this morning. It was this morning. So I'm coming down the hill, Port Jefferson Hill there, and I'm looking and I can see through the trees and I'm like, what is that? I've driven down this hill a lot and I know there's nothing that's over there that looks like that. What is that? What I was processing was that there was water there and I was seeing the sunrise reflection off this water that's not normally there. And so I was like, wow, that's a lot of water. And so we're getting a bit of flooding and those things. And so whatever it was that your week brought you, I hope and I pray that you remembered our five S's of how we are going to be people within the church. How was your surrender this week? Did you do a good job of that? Or was it harder? Were you surrounded? Did you remain surrounded by other people? Not just any other people, but people that can build you up in the faith and help you along the way. Were you spirit-led? Making good spirit-led decisions? Maybe doing things that are hard? Were you self-fed? In other words, making sure that you're taking time to pick that spoon up, right? You're using the knife and fork in the Word of God in order to digest it and pick it up. And then how did you take all of that and then use it to be sent to the world? Sent to the world is where we take our relationship with God, our private personal relationship, we take it out to the world and the world can see it. That's what being sent means. Now, we've taken time to build our foundation on the Word of God. And we started last week and we're going through this whole season of Lent. And we started by what does a foundation look like and where is it? And how do we use it and what do we need? And what we got to do is we got to clear the ground away. We did that last week. And we formed the footers and we put the nice, solid, holy scripture-based foundation down. But now what? We talked about it last week. When you build on that solid foundation, the storms of the world will not crush you. They will not knock you over and you will not be defeated. This is the way it works. And without that solid foundation, and this is one of the reasons why, I think, Reese, you might have heard this last night. Again, for me, I urged you to stay together with other believers, stay together with other believers, stay together with other believers, because when you separate yourself from that, you can study the Bible all you want by yourself, but it doesn't come alive and it doesn't make you strong. Get those other people involved in your life that you're both being lifted up, you're all being lifted together because it is stronger and keeps you more accountable. It's good for you. So that way, when this foundation is built, you're not just trying to hold the house up on your own, right? Oh, I've got the Word of God. That's all I need. Well, maybe not. And so as we're building this foundation on the scriptures, I was reminded of Paul's letter to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, 16 through 17. He tells him that all scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong, and it teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. We want to know right, we want to know wrong, we want to know good, we want to know bad, and we want to be equipped to go and do what it is that he's called us to do. When we are living our life, and it seems kind of fruitless, it seems kind of scattered, it seems kind of it's likely because God is calling us to do something with that life, and we're not quite sure what it is yet. What we need to do is dig into the scriptures. Get into those groups of people that can hold you up in those scriptures, that can hold you up in that spirit, because that's where we're going to find it. That's where God's going to unlock it. And then when you do, when you start living into that, life becomes different. It does. And I'm not talking about your job. I'm not talking about your career or your school. I'm talking about what you do physically with your life in front of other people. So Jesus in today's text, if we're going to see this, let's see it for what it is. In fact, I need to start on the premise that if you have a theology that if you are under temptations that you're bad or you're immature in your faith, I encourage you to throw that away with this text, please. Because if anyone was pure of heart and solid and good, it was Jesus. Fully God, fully man, did not sin. This is Jesus. And the devil's still coming to tempt him, just so you know. Temptation is not a sign of your spiritual maturity. In fact, if you are really being tempted, it probably means you are spiritually mature and he's trying to get at you pretty hard. Look at what he does to Jesus in today's text. Our spiritual maturity isn't easier or better. It gets harder. What was the one line? I can't even remember what Christian rap song it is. But the next boss, I'm going to level up, right? Remember those? You used to play video games when you were a kid? Remember the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles? You go across the screen and then go to the next screen and the next screen. Well, each time you leveled up, the boss gets harder and the boss gets harder and the boss gets harder. That's what he's talking about. And that's what happens in our faith, in our life. We get through the next thing and it's going to get harder. And we get through the next thing and it's going to be harder. And God is using that to mature our faith, to build that character, to show us the directions and things that we're supposed to be going towards. And so we see this kind of lived out here in Jesus. And when we take a look at these temptations today, I want us to focus in on how Jesus was tempted, but then the power that he used in order to resist that temptation. Look at how. And there's probably going to be some things today that you're going to say, I didn't think about that. And that's okay. Because that's what God does. He opens the word, he describes it, and he sees it, and we get to see it a new way. And I've done this a million times on a million times, right? So let's go to that first temptation. And he looks at Jesus. He knows he's weak. The Spirit, by the way, this is after his baptism, which he said had to happen, because that's the way the Holy Spirit's going to come upon his physical fleshness, his humanness, and then leads him. And why would the Holy Spirit lead Jesus out into the desert to be tempted? Because he had to. He had to be perfect. If he was going to be the once-for-all sacrifice, he had to be the perfect Lamb of God. He had to be fully God and fully human, so his fully humanness had to be fully tempted, just like us. And with this temptation now comes a strong pull for him to maybe not be all God. So the devil comes to him, and I love the first one, right? The first one, he comes to him with, if you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Not sure I would choose bread, right? But jelly donuts, let's go, right? And we look at that text, and we immediately go, oh, well, he is, you can read several commentaries and theological studies, and they're going to go, well, he was tempting his physical human hunger. He was a human being, and his hunger was so strong after 40 days in the desert. Little old me, not a doctor of anything. I read this and I can't get past the first two-letter word. If. If. Short. It's such a short word, and yet it holds so much weight. Go back to the Garden of Eden and go back to the first temptation. What does he say to her? Well, if you eat it, he's surely not going to kill you. If you eat it, nothing bad's going to happen. He just doesn't want you to be as smart as you. Or he just doesn't want you to be as smart as him. There's something that we forget in this life because we are built on emotions and we're built on logic. And the logic is that the devil is here to tempt me and to get me to do bad things, but I just want to be happy. I just want to enjoy myself. What we forget is the devil is always, the only power that he really has is to deceive, to lie to you, and to get you to believe it. And so the first thing that he does to Jesus is not tempt him with hunger, but tempt him with whether or not he may be the Son of God. Now, why would the devil, who knows more about Scripture than I've ever forgotten, how would he know to go there first? Well, he knows the Son of God is what's going to destroy me. And if I can attack him at the heart of who he really is, and I can get that deity of his to be stripped away, which is what the world's doing to him, by the way. If I could pull that deity away from him, he'll bow down and worship me and all this will be gone and I'll get to reign. So if you are the Son of God, turn this stone into a loaf of bread. Well, Jesus he's caught in the middle here. He knows that Satan knows who he is, or he wouldn't have called him the Son of God in the first place. So if I don't turn this loaf into, or this stone into a loaf of bread, he wins. I'm not showing him that I'm the Son of God. I am not able to prove to him that I'm the Son of God. And yet if I don't turn it into a loaf of bread, well, I might starve. And I'm not, again, proving to him I am who I am. And as Jesus is mulling over all of this, the thing that stands out to him is his teaching. The teaching, the teaching, the teaching. See, as a young Jewish lad, he would have grown up reciting his scriptures, going to the temple regularly. He would have known the scriptures. He would have known what God has made the people of Israel to be. And what does he do? I'm going to go to Deuteronomy 8:3, and I'm going to look at you, Satan, and say, people do not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. If God wants me to be alive for this moment to resist this temptation, then he'll keep me alive. You remember, even in the wilderness with the Israelites after their exile, he gave them manna from heaven. He gave them food every day. And what did those Israelites do with it? I'm so sick of manna. And God's like, all right, I'll give you quail. I'll give you some quail to eat. Oh, I'm so sick of quail. And so you have Jesus who's torn now. He's being directly tempted by the devil. Just make this stone into a loaf of bread and eat. And he's like, I got to remember my teaching, and I remember the strength of the Holy Spirit that's here with me, holding me up. And I know that it's not just bread that I need. I need more. And so the second temptation then, the devil digs his heels in. Oh, you're going to use the scripture trick. Ha! Well, I know scripture too there, buddy. And he looks at him and he begins it again. If, second time, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God, let's go up to the top of the temple. It's a long ways up. Jump off. Because it says in Scripture that he will use his angels to come to your rescue. He will not even let your foot hurt on a stone. And he goes to Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12, does the devil. He recites scripture. Yeah, that's why he's a bad dude. Because he can make that say whatever you want it to think, right? And so Jesus comes back and he says, okay, wait a minute. I've got to test this because he's now using the scriptures that I know against me. And so I find it curious that he goes back to Deuteronomy 6 again. Again, these are the laws that he would have learned as a child over and over and over and over, as raised up to be. He's got the power of the Holy Spirit that's there with him, helping him. And he rests in this knowledge and he says, well, Deuteronomy 6:16 says, you must not test the Lord your God. Now, this roof on this building's pretty high. And I don't know about you, but if somebody tried to challenge me to say, go outside, stand on the peak of that roof, and I want you to jump off because God will protect you. That's what the scriptures say. How many of you would go, well, you're right, he will. Right? Unfortunately, Jesus really could have just said, no, there's a thing called gravity, and I'm going to die. The physical person in me would die. The Son of God part of me wouldn't. But the Son of God part of me knows I shouldn't push him. Now, you've heard me recently say to make sure to test what I say with scripture, right? Get in scriptures on your own, test what I'm saying, because hopefully what I'm saying aligns with scripture. That's necessary for you to do that. That keeps me right. That keeps you in line. That keeps all of us together on a focused common truth. However, don't test God. Parents, I know you're with me. Do not, and this is even for those of us who know better, don't leave here today, drive 180 miles an hour, and don't care what lane you're in on the road. Physics will win, I promise. God is not here to protect you from yourself. He's here to enlighten you so that you will be around for a while so you can learn, love, and experience heaven on earth. That's what you're here for. So don't push him and don't test him. Even Jesus is understanding that. I flashed forward earlier to him in the Garden of Gethsemane. He was testing him a little bit. And that's because the earthly side of him loved these people. He said, God, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do this. But I'm going to follow you anyway. I'm going to follow you anyway because I know if I don't, they don't stand a chance. This is what he was thinking in that moment. I can't test him. I know his plan. I know his purpose, and I can't test him. So he tries twice to get him to doubt who he is and even tries to use scripture against him. Well, then the third time, he's losing his patience, you can tell. But Jesus is also losing his patience with it as well. He's losing it because he's now like, I know exactly how I can get you. I know exactly how I can make you break. And so he takes him up on a mountain. He says, look, everything that you can see, I will give it to you if you'll just bow down and worship me. Now we think, when we read this text, we think power, greed, materialism, right? I did a lot of opening of different studies and none of it went to where I thought it was gonna go. Because that's not at all what he's tempting him with. Looks like it on the surface. See, Jesus knows the outcome of his plan. The devil has already called him the Son of God twice. He knows the plan. He knows that this is the guy that ends my reign. This is the guy that makes it all go away. Not that I'm ever going to lose my ability to try and cheat these people out of their life, but that in the end, I'm not going to win. How can I get that to not happen? Well, he's human. And he is going to endure the harshest of pain. Because not only is it going to be a physical pain that's absolutely unbearable, but his best friends are going to run away and deny him. People closest to him are actually going to be the ones that betray him and push him into that. He can't trust anybody. This guy is going to have to go through all of this stuff to make this happen. Oh, that's how. See, Jesus, I will just give all of this to you. You won't have to go through any of that pain. You won't have to be hurt by anybody. I'll just give it to you. And Jesus has enough. Get out! I'm sick of talking to you. You have no power here on this earth. You have no power over this mortal body that I'm walking in any more than you do the holy God of all creation body that I also have. You're nothing. Stop tempting me and go away. It's like the first time Jesus uses Jesus' power, right? How often do we see this and we miss that? In today's text, Jesus not only uses his foundation on Scripture, but then actually uses his own firm foundation to repel the temptations of the devil. The Holy Spirit is with him. It's giving him strength. It's helping him understand. And he uses all of his knowledge, his worldly and earthly knowledge, combined with that Holy Spirit power to resist temptations. And if we look at what temptations really are, it's just a manipulation of your feelings and your emotions. How many of you know what it feels like to be hungry? Like really hungry? No, I've seen a lot of no's, right? I think we need like a 36-hour fast then or something, right? We need to feel what that feels like. We need something to get that back. How many of you get sad or you get upset really easily? Right? It only takes one, like for me, it only takes one person in the drive to cut me off and right. Roar! Jesus loves you, by the way. Right? Yeah. It's an emotion. And yet with the emotions and the feelings, they actually don't carry any weight. I'm not going to tell you that they're wrong. What you feel is what you feel. That is absolutely true. However, the longer you think about what you feel and how you feel it, the less you're going to realize that it's really not that valid. It's really not. Because tomorrow, it doesn't matter what I feel like. Tomorrow, it doesn't matter what my hunger is or what food I ate or what my emotional state is. That sun is going to come up on the horizon tomorrow morning, God willing, because God's the only one that's going to stop it. And I'm going to get another day. And my emotions and my feelings from the day before, as much as it is real to us and it makes us feel because that's who God is, because that's who he created us to be, they're not real. Was Eve really hungry? Did she really want knowledge? How did she feel after she gave in and ate that fruit? Well, they immediately hid from him. They didn't even know they were naked before that. Like, it unlocked all of the things that we fight and face every day. Jesus uses scriptural knowledge to acknowledge the worldly temptations of the devil and to understand that the only things that he can manipulate are things that are temporary. Feelings, emotions, material things, desires, all so that he can right the wrong in what it is that we were doing or what we would do. Jesus had to resist that to save us from our sin and provide us for a way to eternity. And so today, we entitled it God of the World. The three temptations of Jesus are basically that. Which do you want? Do you want food? Do you want to prove God right or wrong? Do you want all the power in the world? All the stuff. What do you want? Or do you just want a life lived with God that sucks? Excuse my language. There's pain. There's suffering. There's grief. There's hurt. Physical hurt, too, not just emotional and mental hurt. But that relationship with him, as it withstands all those things, it stands for eternity. And there's nothing the devil can do about it because he's already lost. He knows he's already lost, but boy, he sure is trying to take as many with him as he can. So what do you choose? Do we choose temporary things, fleeting emotions, our minds, which are eternal and in communion with the God of all creation at all times? That hit me this week. Like, wow, let that sink in for a minute. God's not just there when you speak to him. He's there all the time. This world has a way of tricking us. It has a way of tricking us into thinking that our emotions and our feelings have eternal weight, that our earthly pleasures and desires are worth something. And unfortunately, Jesus shows us that they're not. In resisting temptation, Jesus shows us how hard this life can be, and yet how rewarding an eternal life really is. Amen. Before we go on to communion, let's pray over our offering this morning. Father in heaven, we pray that you would accept us as an offering. In your Psalms, you don't want us to bring a burnt offering anymore. None of it's going to be good enough, and none of it's as worth as much as our soul. So God, today we bring you as our offering. In response to your word, we give you back everything that is already yours. From the moment we take our first breath, you're going to make sure we take a last one, and we don't know when that is. It could be 2 years, it could be 103 years. And whatever it is, God, you've placed a limitation on that, and everything in between that is a gift. And so we take whatever we have, whatever we can provide, and we give it back to you. If we have money, we put it in that box. If we have time and energy, we go and volunteer. If we have gifts and talents, we lead. And whatever it is, God, we just give it back to you that you might bless it and multiply it and make it grow within us, that we would be your hands and feet to the world, and that because of you, God, the world would see you in us and want more of you. That is our offering back to you, ourselves, in the name of Jesus, who makes everything possible with the power and strength of your Holy Spirit that's here now. Amen. As we come to the table of communion today, I know we had this discussion. I didn't look at you on purpose. We had this discussion in our Faith Builders group this week, about communion and about things and about worship. And I kind of went there because of the things that I've been learning and hearing, in which the Spirit works however it wants to work. It doesn't need our structure. It doesn't need a fountain. It doesn't need us to do things a certain way. The Spirit works. He does what he wants to do, right? So as we go through this, because I'm sure she's got the slides, as we go through this, this is not intended for you to feel stuck. The only reason that we go through this is to do things that we need to make sure that we do in this present moment. See, sacrament of baptism, see where I was going? I'm stuck in class. The sacrament of Holy Communion is an experience. It's a chance for you and I to come to the table of God and to partake in the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. It's where life changing happens. And in order to do that, the scriptures tell us that we have to come with a repentant heart. That means we have to do things like making sure we ask for forgiveness and making sure that repentance, which means turn and go the other way, is what sees us happening here at the table. So when I go through things like the structure that we have, it's so that we don't forget to do those things. We not only do that, but we do it together. Because as you look around this room, you're the body of Christ. You're this family together. And if one of you is hurting, you're all hurting. And if one of you is struggling, you're all struggling. And so that togetherness happens here in this moment. And that's why you guys have a part in those words too. In 1 John 4:7-9, it says, "Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And God's love was revealed among us in this way. He sent his only son into the world that we might live through him." Almighty God, would you pray with me? "Unto whom all hearts are open and all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen." Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him and who earnestly repent of their sin, who seek to live in peace with one another, and therefore let us confess our sin before God and one another. You can pray this, or you can pray something that you want to in your head. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church, and we have not done your will. We have broken your law, and we have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray, and free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves his love, God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is a right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The word Hosanna meaning save, by the way. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We proclaim the mystery of faith and what we believe. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen. I can't imagine that moment of what it would have been like. Hey, we're just going to get together for the Passover. You know, that thing we've been doing for thousands of years, this same time, all the time. I can't imagine the overwhelmingness of it, and it was just going to be a normal day, normal time. We had the structure, we had it set. We were supposed to say these words. We're supposed to go through this because it helps us remember how God delivered us from slavery in Egypt. And then Jesus, in the middle of this, he takes the bread right in the middle of this feast, and he lifts it to heaven like he's supposed to. He blesses it, and he thanks his Father for it. And then he breaks that bread, and instead of saying what he was supposed to say, he says, "Friends, this is my body, and I'm going to give it to you." And I'm sure they were completely unaware, caught off guard, had no idea that that was going to happen. And so they probably forgot about it as you go through the steps of that Passover feast. There's one final cup of wine at the end of the night. It's the last thing they do. Jesus takes that cup, and again, He doesn't follow the structure. He lifts it to heaven, he blesses it, and he thanks his Father for it. And then he says, friends, disciples, in this cup is my blood. It's poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. This is a once for all new covenant between God and human beings. This will save you. As often as you can come to this table and do this, remember me. Friends, I pray that as you come to this table, this is where your strength is found. This is where the presence of God is found for you. This is the holy experience of his body and his blood and his sacrifice for you. Can I get Grady and Grady? Can you guys help me today? I'm going younger. Sorry, older. Not to discriminate, there's always another month, right? Thank you. I don't know why, but the Grady and Grady connection just seemed like a thing this morning as I was thinking about it. As we do our communion, you'll be coming to the center. You'll form two lines on your side and on your side, right? Step up, and I will hand you the bread. Take and eat. And then these young, fine gentlemen will offer you the blood of Christ, which will take the cup, drink the cup, put your empty cup then in that basket right next to them. The table is set for you, and he's welcoming you today.
Full, and it's never too late.
That your son would be able to resist the temptations of this world so that we would have comfort and strength in him, so that we would have eternal life available to us, that you would love us enough that you would put your own son in that position, give him the strength to resist, and then give him the strength to withstand the cross, a punishment that we deserve. God, may this great gift that we've experienced here today, may it make us different people. May we see you in a different way. May we rely on you more. May we leave the things of the past in the past, and may we move forward with a life that looks different, acts different, and smells different. That we could be different creations in you, so much so that the world around us would be excited and want to know you. Thank you, Jesus, for everything. Amen. If you're able to stand and join us in our closing hymn today, we're going to sing Freely, Freely. Hopefully we've been set free. So I want to share with you a story to close. It's not a good story. Matter of fact, it's actually really tragic, but it's a good explanation, a good metaphor, if you will. In a sermon by Dennis Davidson, he recalled a news story in Florida. And I'm not sure if the baby Burmese python came with a warning, but if not, it should have. The Oxford, Florida family that brought the serpent home as a pet would one day live to regret allowing such a creature into their house. The snake, now 12 feet long, broke out of the glass aquarium during the night. Silently, it slithered into the bedroom of a 2-year-old girl, wrapped itself around her defenseless body, and strangled her to death. A horrible, yet an entirely preventable tragedy. I want to tell you that Satan, the old serpent, he works tirelessly to get us to believe that allowing him into the house is no real consequence or danger. After all, we know how to restrain him behind the aquarium glass. Unfortunately, we can't control him as much as we think, and a snake is always going to be a snake. Friends, hopefully you're able to withstand temptations this week, and hopefully God's speaking into your life and things are getting different for you. He has a great, abundant life that he's calling you to, and I hope that we're living into that. Join me as we sing our closing doxology.